action management technologies that deliver superior workplace results for CBRE clients. Prior to his role in the leadership team, William spent 3 years as a transaction manager, negotiating and executing multi-market corporate real estate transactions for institutional, mid-cap, and private equity clients. His responsibilities included interfacing with CBRE's cross-functional service lines and third-party entities to complete assignments across the globe. He has helped create and implement portfolio management strategies and provided support services to corporate real estate design decision makers and portfolio managers. Prior to his prior professional experience includes analyzing, tracking, and researching office and industrial market performance, strategy consulting, and business development. Let's welcome William with his very impressive resume to the stage.
I really don't know where all that came from. Sound like somebody else. So forgive me for sitting because I have some material I just wanted to walk through. And the first thing I wanted to say, I was extremely interested and intrigued with all the questions that were coming up earlier with the first few sessions, because for me, it's not too long ago that I was still wrestling with many of the same types of questions. You know, what's my range of approaches for deciding what I want to do, or how do I balance ambition and excellence in the workplace, but also not letting that take over as my primary, kind of focus. And those are all extremely relevant, and they're not questions just for the beginning of your career. They're questions that really follow you all the way through, and there's always a coming back to recalibrate and ask those. So what I wanted to focus on today was really answering the call to work well, and really do that in three sort of big topic areas. One has to do with what is work and what's my context for work, to share some of that with you. Secondly, to really talk about the characteristics and trends of the workplace today, and while some of those things are certainly welcome and good, what the effect and impact of those things are for us today. And then the last piece was really to talk about certain tensions that we should hold in balance as we navigate today's workplace. I would love to finish sooner so we can kind of talk to some more questions, because I was itching to chime in, but I just really wanted to hear what you guys have to say, and also what the really good speakers we had before us have to say. So that was really, I took a lot of notes. I don't know if you guys did, but I had a whole page of notes from that. That was great. So work context, just wanted to share a little bit. I studied business, and I wanted to be very clear, when you think about work, it's broader than just the corporate environment, Fortune 500 or the large companies, or even in business. You've got people who work in public service. We heard and talked a little about the healthcare sector. You have people who work in many wide varieties of industries. But it's also not just a work or vocation for which you're paid. Any effort exerted towards a purpose or an end is work. And so the work you do at home, the work you do for yourself, if you're in a sport or if you work out, whatever it is, everything that you actually do where you're exerting some kind of effort, you can define that as work. And God has a purpose in every one of those circles. For purposes of today, I'm talking about, again, my experience. I work in a large global company, 80,000 people, and my context is really that. I work at home, so I work from home some of the time. I'm on the road some of the time. I'm in the office, and it's really kind of a feature of many of our jobs today, where work is just highly mobile, and it brings the extra challenge of how do you develop deep, lasting relationships when things are so virtual and things are not, physically in place all the time. So that's one of the things that I deal with in my work context. But the second thing I wanted to kind of get into was, again, what does work look like today? Some of what you're experiencing. I am a Gen Xer, I've been told, and it's a little bit different than a lot of the talk about millennials. In our company, we actually think about millennials as human beings, just like everyone else who are in that life stage. They're not this weird like category or spoiled brats or whatever. I mean, everybody goes through that particular life stage. You came out of your primary formative years in college, you're kind of launching your career, you sort of make your mark and figure out where you're gonna grow and what you're gonna do. We all went through that. It's a life stage thing, but it's a life stage experience in a little bit of a different context. And today, some of the things that you hear about economy, we're in an information and digital economy. So a lot of what we have to do relates with people. You know, we're always dealing with people every time in the service economy, and you're always dealing with information and data and analytics in a digital age. And it's different than being on a farm or being on an assembly line. And so that's led to a number of things that over the years, values such as collaboration, you hear that as a big buzzword. We want workplaces and environments where there's a lot of collaboration. One of the questions I ask is it how productive is it? If you have an open workplace environment and everybody is collaborating, there's a lot of social interaction going on. The big question is, well, are you actually being productive, and is it fruitful both for you and for the company? Another big value, community. And there's a growing subsector of workplace environments that are really built around creating and facilitating interactions and community in the workplace. And they put amenities in the spaces, they put services of all kinds. They have a concierge instead of a receptionist. And the goal is to make the workplace as comfortable as possible. And if you work for Google in Silicon Valley, you don't even have to leave the place. They have the food there, they have beds, they have showers, they have all the things that you might ever want to do. I think they even have Parents Weekend, so you can bring your parents there if you want. But having community doesn't replace the depth of relationships. So just because you have all this community, does that mean that your relationships actually go deep? And are they substantial, and are they meaningful? And then the last thing about innovation. Here's a water bottle, and when Wayne Grudem talks about this, you can look online, and he talks a little about the amazing gift that God has given us to work, to make things that if Adam and Eve showed up, in proper clothes, by the way, but if they showed up today, and they saw this, they would say, well, exactly what is this? And you would say, it's a water bottle, and you can buy it at the store, and they can ship it to you, or an Amazon drone can drop it off. And anytime you want, you have clear, purified, consistently the same product, water, you can get this anywhere. And he would be blown away because he would have to like trudge down to a brook and maybe fill it with the water and drink it. And all the materials that were used for this, the plastic, came from the ground. And he would say, well, how do you know that there was oil in the ground that we have to go deep and get it and refine it and process it and come up with this material, and it could be formed in this way with the label, and then you could actually harvest water and distribute it. And you would say, God gave us that wisdom, and God gave us that ability to think through material science and all the logistics of the supply chain that would make this happen. And so work has, especially meaningful productive work, glorifies God because it's an expression of his creativity, and it's great to have innovation. It makes your life easier, it brings convenience of different kinds, it raises standards of living. But the question I have is, at some point, how much are we making the shiny and the new thing our God, our replacement idol, our counterfeit for who God is? Because innovation is good, and we should create, and we should advance. And in fact, we shrivel when we don't create, because that's part of our identity. But we can't replace God with that. So it has a place, a proper place. I think also of the now economy, the immediate impulse, the I deserve, and the entitlement. And those, again, are things that I don't think are unique just to millennials. We all go through, we all struggle with that. But that's a function and a feature of the world that we live in today. So the big question is, how do you wrestle, how do you handle, how do you deal with these realities in the work that we do? As an individual, how do you deal with that with your coworker? How do you deal with that with the choices that you make about careers that you're, the career that you're pursuing, et cetera? I want to talk about three tensions that I believe are important to hold in balance. Maybe it's more opinion than an academic, research-based delivery of what I think has been helpful. But I'll start with a personal example. I was a college athlete. I was a track and field athlete in college. And I had ambitions for what that would do. I really invested a lot of time and effort and really was excited about it. And my freshman year, my sophomore year, I would typically map out all the track meets that we would have and the marks that I wanted to obtain. I had this whole plan, a master plan of what I was going to do. began to really dislike the feeling of my life and the winds of my sentiments were determined by the outcome of the activity that I did. And at some point I was like, this really is not healthy, it's not helpful, I need something different. And while God has given us abilities and absolutely expects us to go full force and use them, he also is not calling us to be slaves to the outcomes tied to those things. And the way this was resolved for me was in a pivotal weekend experience where I was going through a devotional and I was just thinking about how literally everything that we do is an expression of worship. Worship is really not just singing a song. It's not just being the one who's preaching, not just sitting in a seat and praying with your hands up. That's a part of it. But because we're made in God's image and he made and actually empowers and gives life to every single thing we do on an ongoing basis, the way you read, the way you think, the way you speak, the way you dress, the way you do your job, the way you play your vocation, if you're great at basketball, you can make 3 points, the way you knit, the way you take care of a young one, every single thing that you do is actually worship. It's an expression of something that God as creator has made. And so in all our activity, in all our work, vocation or otherwise, we glorify God when we do it as an act or as an expression of worship. And when I understood that, it completely transformed the rest of my college athletic career. And what happened was, I felt that I was asked and called to do the very best that I could. And there was a question early on about how do you balance ambition and this drive and strive for excellence with, you know, still keeping God as your primary. Because at the end of the day, if we're in a game, or even if we're in a competition of some sort, work can sometimes be like that. What it really means is that I am competing with you for this opportunity or for the preeminence in this thing that I'm doing. If it's a sports event, you're trying to win, right? You're trying to be number one. And my struggle was, if I'm going to be number one, it means that I'm putting, first of all, myself on the pedestal. And secondly, I'm doing that over and above someone else. And thirdly, I risk making that number one pursuit in that area. I risk replacing God with that because, well, is God my number one or is this thing my number one? And I really struggled with that until I understood that what God wants us to do is to go full tilt with all the gifts and abilities and strengths and wisdom and opportunities that he's given us. We need to run 100% and use them to their fullest extent. But the trick is leave the result to God. Because you can't control what happens. You can't control if you get you ace that exam, or you are the final job candidate and you win that job. You cannot control that. And it's a little bit of a different message because we're taught, you know, first of all, we live in a society where it's all work ethic based, right? You eat what you kill. You go out and get it. You're a self-made man. Run, work hard, and if you don't make it, you don't succeed, you know, it's because you didn't try hard enough. We live in that kind of a world. But we also live under the domain of a God who marks the book ends of time. He knows the story from the beginning to the end. And he has the absolute sovereignty and the absolute control. And so we need to actually learn to rest in what he chooses as an outcome. But that's no excuse for us not to put our fullest effort into it. The worry we should have is not whether or not we achieve what we think we want to do. The worry we should have is how are we depending on God as we're doing it. And there are a couple of verses that really help me think through this. And you can write something down because they're really good for reflecting later on. So Proverbs 16:1-3 talks about, we make our plans, but God gives the answer. God determines the outcome. And that is a very true and helpful word when you're struggling with decisions to make. Commit your actions to the Lord. Tim Keller talks about this. Many times we want to commit our plans and ask God to bless the plans, but we'll take care of the actions and we'll do it ourselves. And he flips it and says, well, commit your actions to the Lord. The action that you take, the time you're spending, the investment you're making in different things you're going to do, God will take up the outcomes. He will order and orchestrate what the plan ends up being. And that's important because we don't want to take God's sovereignty as an excuse for apathy. We have to be full priority and commitment conversation. We have to be committed full time to what God has called us to do. One of the dangers that I have in my life is I can very easily say, well, because God is sovereign, he controls everything, it's going to work out the way he wants to work out, so why should I try? If he wants me to succeed, he'll make it happen. But that's apathy, that's sin, that's taking grace for granted. And so those are two tensions. We always strive for excellence, but we leave the results to God. The second thing is really about doing good and pursuing eternity. And for this, I'll use an analogy of an optometrist, a doctor, a Christian doctor, and his wife, after so many years in their career, felt the call to ministry. They packed up. That's my time is up for my short spiel. They packed up, joined a mission, went to Guinea, and their entree was, we will use our medical practice to meet locals, and using our skills in this medical field, then we can share the gospel. And after a number of years, what he began to realize was that he was using his medical skills to provide healing and improve the standard of living of the people that he was working with. They could see, they were able to get different kinds of jobs, their families were being helped, but their souls were not being changed for eternity, and he had this big burden. All I'm doing is I'm contributing to good, but it has no eternal benefit, no eternal value. And so we've probably all moved past the knowledge that we don't go to work just to earn money, just to make more money. I mean, that's well understood, I would assume, in these circles as Christians, right? Our treasures are not here. They're you know, farther out. We're not motivated only by money. And so we're motivated by doing good, social justice, ways of contributing, ways we give back. But in your giving back and in your doing good, do not ignore that what's of lasting value is the eternal investment that you're making in people's lives. So as you're interacting with others, think of ways that you impact them for eternity, not just to raise their standard of living or improve their life, which is still important and called to do, but there's a higher longer-term calling. The last thing I want to talk about is the difference between being and doing. Back to the whole concept of we're in a world that's all about busyness and hurriedness and striving and rushing and go, 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 go. And at some point, you just get tired, you just get worn out, you just get burnt out, because that is what the society is, and it chews you, it spits you out, and there's never an end to it. And how do you handle that? How do you balance that? I had a friend, a wise sort of mentor who basically told me one time, he said, you know, this is a very common dialogue we have. You meet a friend and they say, how are things going? What's going on? You say, oh man, I'm so busy. There's this going on and that going on. And I felt almost guilty for complaining about being busy. He said, well, it's good to be busy if you're busy about the right things. But the balancing tension is when it's time to rest, make sure you rest. Don't take that for granted. Don't ignore or push past. Again, God, who's infinite creator, infinite energy, spent 6 days working hard. He was busy, but you rested. And if God found it important to rest, we should do. We should have an excuse to not do that. So rest when you're supposed to. One of the things I've been working for me lately is just learning to begin to practice more the habit of solitude, building solitude into your day, whether it's in your quiet time, as someone was talking about, whether it's some other time, whether it's the radical thing of taking some time, 10 minutes, in your lunch break, in the middle of a chaotic day, and just tearing yourself away so you can sort of be just basking in God's presence. Find a space, find a place for solitude in your life. Psalm 46, verse 10, be still and know that I am God. Matthew 11, 28, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And the last thing I'll say is, remember that God who marks again the bookend of time, he sees you. First of all, Philippians 1:6, he who began a good work, he will carry it out to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. When God looks at you, he sees you in your full glorified self. He sees you in the perfection that he sees you through Christ. So a lot of times we look at ourselves and we only see our flaws or what we have not yet achieved or what we struggle with. We tend to look at others. others to those same kinds of prisms. But really what God sees is his child, his beloved, a member of his kingdom who's going to be with there for eternity. And yes, you're walking through your journey now, you're kind of hitting your milestone, you're going to fail and struggle, you're going to walk it down. But God has a plan of perfection that's already been set before the beginning of time, that's already there. You have arrived, you just don't see you're going through it. So remember that God is there to secure that for you. That is all I'm going to talk about. I'd love to have some questions or some dialogue. So any reactions to any of that or any questions? Yes.
Thank you, William, and I appreciate what you were talking about God providing the increase. And I work for a ministry called Marketplace Chaplains, and on our marketing team, our verse is 1 Corinthians 3:7, which is, it's not the one who plants or the one who waters who's everything, but God who provides the increase. And we don't have any sales goals or targets. I've been in sales before in corporate environments where you have all your targets and goals, and we don't have any of that. We really just rely on the Holy Spirit leading us, and we've seen just year over year continued growth, and it's all been in trusting and following the Holy Spirit through that. So I want to encourage everybody else to continue to consider what you're saying, because it's really important to know that the marketplace doesn't provide, God provides. So thank you.
The mic for anyone. We need some delay questions.
You had mentioned that we should strive for excellence, but depend on the results, depend on God. How can you help us to get to the point that we actually can incorporate that into our lives, where we really do allow the results to be God's?
Yeah, it's probably not much different than what I said. I think it's hard because I think it was a question earlier about, well, you have these expectations. Somebody was talking about being in consulting. Are you still here? I forgot her name. Tanya or something like that. But Tyler, she's not. Yeah, and I was really kind of wanting to talk about that because absolutely, you have expectations, you have performance priorities, you have goals and targets that have been given to you, and sometimes they don't always be perfectly aligned with what your personal mission is before God. I feel I've gone down the path of really trying to, as I mentioned before with the experience in college, trying to perform or meet up to a certain standard and control and really try to determine what the outcome is by my own actions. And my focus wasn't on how I was working, how I was experiencing God through, how he was changing me, and what he was telling me while I was doing it. My focus was on, am I getting this thing? And I was focused on the end. And I really think God wants us to almost stop in our tracks and experience him while we're working. The reason I believe that is, when you look back in your life, when you look back as you move in your dream, you turn at certain milestones and look back and see where God has brought you, what you will find is that if you and God, at the starting line, both had a blank sheet of paper and God said, you know, Joe, Mary, just script out what your career would be like. Script out what you would achieve and accomplish, your LinkedIn profile 20 years down the road. You could kind of come up and paint this most unimaginable picture of what you thought, like realistically, you might be able to achieve. And then at the end of the day, let's go back and look at what actually happened, which is how God led you and navigated you and did left turns and right turns and pivoted you. And I guarantee you, your vision of where you might want to go would pale in comparison to what God would be doing in your career and in your life and the people you've touched and where he's led you. You cannot script that out. You cannot dream big enough beyond what God would do. So I would just say, for me, and if it's an opinion or whatever, I would still say we should pray for the ability to trust God with the outcomes, but really focus on the journey and what he's teaching us and having us experience while we're working through it, because, you know, he will blow you away. He would, you know, you cannot outdream or outthink God for your career. That thing you want so bad, it's not even close to what he's preparing for you. And God never takes you to the edge of a cliff and just leaves you there to hang around. He will, you know, raise you in the family and in the church and with the people and get training and education and opportunities. And he won't do all that. And all of a sudden, you get to, like, you know, I'm 26, 27, I'm thinking what the next thing is. I'm 32 and I need this career pivot. And maybe I even got let go and I have to figure out what to do. He won't leave you hanging there after he's built that whole foundation. He has a plan. Trust him with it. You can't outdream God. So hopefully that's how I think about it.
William, actually, let me ask you a quick question. Can you share with the group a little bit about your journey? Just living, coming from Africa, living in Ghana, and then from that point, even rising up the ranks and what you're doing at CDRE, because you've really grown in your company in a very, very big way.
Yes, so I'll try. So certainly have had an interesting both upbringing and career. So grew up, was born and raised in Ghana when I was four. My dad was a university professor, moved the family to Texas for a teaching appointment. We lived there for 3 years. We lived in Scotland, England, and Nigeria. Went back to high school in Ghana, and then came to college in the U.S. on a track and field scholarship. And my faith journey, so grew up in a Christian home, and from the earliest that I can remember, I was involved in church, involved in youth group, got involved in music and all of that. It was in high school that I first encountered in a meaningful way what it meant, what the gospel really meant, what it meant to give your life to God. And I remember saying that prayer and committing, but I never quite understood what it was to submit your life to him. And that happened in college. One experience was I spent my freshman year in the international house, and we had students from all over the world. And I became close friends with a group of about 13 people from a number of countries and of all kinds of faiths. And I met a crisis that year, because here was I grew up as a Christian. I'm hanging out with these people who are Muslims, atheists, and other. And we generally are agreeable among each other. They're decent people. They respect and regard one another. We get along. And in spite of our differences, we actually feel very well connected together. So why is my faith the superior faith over and above theirs? And what grounds do I have to tell them, well, the way you grew up is not legitimate, but actually mine is? What it pushed me to do was to go to God and say, God, I can't be a Christian just because my parents brought me up that way. It has to be something that's personal. And the resolution for me was, if it was just left with me and God in the room and there was no other witness, would I still follow him? And when I had come to the answer yes in that dialogue, that gave me a little bit of peace, and I marked that as a milestone in my career. And then, if any of you have read John Piper, if any of you have read any of that, and the whole desiring God theme of God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him, I just learned to seek God, or at least strive and point my direction to seek God as my number one, because in doing so, his glory and seeking that actually fulfilled me the very most. And it also is what he created us for. That was another marker in my faith journey. And then, you know, after that, I think it's really just been learning and growing through work, through family. We have four kids, and they're young, 11, 9, 7, 5. So that's a big kind of struggle and learning process. But God has just been very much a blessing to me in my career, and I think it's been entirely his doing, but he's provided opportunities. And in fact, it creates, in my mind, more and more of a burden to look for ways to return that to other people who may have a benefit for something that I can offer and I can give because of what God's given me. Because he didn't provide all of those things for me to sit back and happy and enjoy. He provided that because he wants to use that. And so find out something that God has given you as a gift, an ability you have, some knowledge, a skill set, some relationships, some connections you have, and see how you can turn that to benefit or to use in some of those you have. Because God blesses generous givers, and it's not just talking about material things. It's about your career. How are you mentoring and investing in someone that builds a career indirectly? And that's just been my experience. So I don't know if that Tommy's walked away. Oh, he's there. Hopefully that answers your question. Any others? Sorry. So how do you balance striving for excellence but also building in times of rest? I think you have to have a plan and you have to stick to that plan. And that plan should include some very dedicated or specific times for rest. And again, it's not something that I do perfectly. I'm the first to admit that there are days when I just find myself at the end of the day, I'm like, where did I take that time to sit down and focus on God? But this is a lifelong journey, and I think you have to figure out for you what is the best moment in my day and in my week to have that space and preserve that and protect it, and allow God to, you know, experience God in that moment of rest. And then for the other, 75% of your week or whatever it is, run hard. Don't let up. Don't hold back. Because God gave you all those abilities. Do the very best you can in those. I think we've lost the art of the Sabbath, and so Sundays, and maybe there's another day for you that is kind of that Sabbath, but try not to have work or other things impede and invade that space. There is a reason for that. That's sort of how I would think about it. Preserve some planned time, right, for the discipline or time to really build that, but also when you're running, you run hard. I think my time is up. I'll be around for a little bit if there are any questions, and also I think if you reach out to Tom or anyone, you're more than welcome to get in touch. Love to sit down and chat or answer any questions that anyone has at any point, but thank you for your time.
Thank you.